series. Dr. Goodman was awarded her doctorate at the University of California, Davis, in sociology, where her work was on focused on the Danish resistance and rescued Jews in Denmark during World War II. Prior to her retirement in 2013, Dr. Goodman did what I do now. Scholars, from witnesses of genocide and its effects. So it is most appropriate that she introduce us to Raphael Lemkin and offer her interpretation of the essential concept of this course, the concept of genocide. Please welcome Professor Myrna Goodman.
That felt a little bit like a eulogy. I have indeed spent an awful lot of time contemplating the concept of genocide. What I hope to do today, is it on the? For today's lecture, what I hope to do is to introduce you to the concept of genocide. We all hear it, but it has some specific and non-specific meanings. I want to give you a historical overview of what was only until the middle of the 20th century referred to as genocide. I feel very strongly that people should know about Raphael Lemkin because he almost single-handedly is responsible for the United Nations naming genocide what it is and creating a convention or a set of rules by which and laws by which to judge genocide. I hope we can understand the genocidal process. It's not something that happens overnight. And then finally, I'd like to leave you not entirely feeling hopeless, but also with some notion of what can be done. The sociologist Leo Kuyper stated that the word is new, the concept is ancient. Important questions arise as we contemplate the concept of genocide. Primarily among them are, what are the origins of the term genocide? Why was it essential to frame it as a legal concept? And how has our understanding of genocide evolved? The term genocide did not exist before 1944. In the shadow of the Holocaust, there was no specific legal definition which could specify the crime of the systematic destruction of a particular group of people. Now, genocide is a very specific term referring to violent crimes committed against groups with the intent to destroy them and to destroy their very existence. In 1948, those acts were formally codified or brought into law and international law by the United Nations. As we will see, that was due in no small part to the tireless efforts of one person, Raphael Lemkin. Because of his tireless efforts, the United States eventually approved a treaty or a convention that established genocide as an international crime. So my goal today is to provide you with an understanding of the history of the phenomena, to explore its origins as a legally punishable crime, and to raise your awareness of its persistence. We're going to look at some historical examples of what we might call mass death. Some of the earliest recorded genocides occurred in ancient Greece. The massacre at Milos occurred during the Peloponnesian Wars. Now, everybody knows about the Peloponnesian Wars, right? It was a long time ago, around 416 BC. These are not comprehensive, but I've picked them out to help show you how genocide or mass death has persisted. Christians during the Middle Ages, approximately the 9th to the 14th centuries, imposed religiously sanctified campaigns against what they called unbelievers. And those unbelievers were, in this case, the Cathars in France, who chose to have their own liturgy. But they also did so during the Crusades, in Germany against the Jews, or in the Holy Land and in the Middle East, or Holy Land of the Middle East. Surprisingly, early missionaries to Japan were admired for their knowledge of the outside world, but their proselytizing was entirely unwelcome. They persisted in their zeal, however, and made large inroads among the populations. The persecutions of Christians began with the murder of Jesuit missionaries, and then extended to all Christians, Europeans, or Japanese Christians. This persecution eventually led to the imposition of the exclusion orders, and those exclusion orders kept all foreigners away from Japan until the 19th century. Lest we think genocide is strictly a foreign phenomenon, we must remember that over 150,000 Native Americans lived sustainably in California prior to the gold rush. They existed supporting themselves mostly by hunting, gathering, and fishing, but their lives were drastically changed in 1848 when James Marshall discovered that gold metal in the American River at Coloma. By 1870, there was an estimated Native population of only 31,000 California Native Americans. Over 60% of the indigenous people died from disease introduced by hundreds of thousands of so-called 49ers. Local tribes were also systematically chased off their lands, marched to missions, which you can visit in Sonoma, and reservations, enslaved and brutally massacred. In 1851, the California state government paid $1 million for scalping excursions. You could still get $5 for a severed Indian head in Shasta in 1855, and 25 cents for a scalp in Honey Lake in 1863. Of the 4,000 Native American children, over 4,000 Native American children were sold, and their prices ranged from $60 for a boy to $200 for a girl. I'll get it. It takes me a while, but once I learn it, I'm good at it. Early definitions of widespread murder included barbarism and mass death. In the 19th and early 20th centuries, attempts to define and prevent war crimes included preventative international treaties, which define mass death as crimes against humanity. The Geneva Conventions were a series of agreements addressing the treatment of prisoners of war, the sick, wounded, and dead in battle, and were first made at Geneva in Switzerland in 1864. Subsequently, they were accepted in later revisions by most nations. The Hague Conventions were among the first formal statements of the laws of war and war crimes, and were among the first in international law. The 20th century is often known as the century of genocide, the genocidal century. So what were the first instances of mass death and what has been known as the century of genocide? The Herero genocide was a campaign of racial extermination and collective punishment that the German Empire, the colonial empire, undertook in German Southwest Africa. That's the modern-day Namibia. And it was focused against the Herero peoples. It is considered the first genocide of the 20th century and took place between 1904 and 1907. I've got 1905 up there. It was a campaign of racial extermination and collective punishment that the German Empire took against the Southwest Africa. We come now to the Armenian genocide in 1915, although much of what happened on either side of that. Ambassador Hans Morgenthau cabled Washington. He was the ambassador to Turkey. And he clearly described the Turkish campaign, and I quote, "Persecution of Armenians is assuming unprecedented proportions. Reports from widely scattered districts indicate there is a systematic attempt to uproot peaceful Armenian populations. Arbitrary arrests, terrible tortures, wholesale expulsions, and deportations from one end of the empire to the other, accompanied by frequent instances of rape, pillage, and murder, turning into massacre, are bringing destruction and destitution to them." He also said that these measures are not in response to population or fanatical demand, but are purely arbitrary and directed from Constantinople, which was the capital of Turkey. "In the name of military necessity, often in districts where no military operations are likely to take place, there seems to be a systematic plan to crush the Armenian race." Race being used loosely there. The premeditated destruction of the Armenian people was intended to destroy humans, but the Turks also attempted to erase the centuries-old Armenian culture. They destroyed major objects of Armenian cultural, religious, historical, and communal heritage. And it was a strategic plan of both the genocide itself and the post-genocidal campaign of denial. As we have seen, the Geneva Convention did not have a legal framework that allowed for the prosecution of perpetrators of the Armenian, quote, mass deaths and atrocities. So we come to Raphael Lemkin. Very interesting life, although a very short one by standards. He was born in 1901 in eastern Poland. He grew up in a Jewish family in a town in that area. He developed a talent for languages. He ended up mastering a dozen or more, and a passionate curiosity about the cultures that produced them. Broadly educated in Poland, Germany, and France, he was struck by accounts of the suffering of Christians at Roman hands and its parallel in the pogroms that afflicted Jews, the Jews of Eastern Europe, which he witnessed as a child himself. And ultimately, he went on and fled Poland in 1934 when the Germans invaded Poland, and eventually framed the concept of genocide in 1943. The pogroms that he experienced prompted his lifelong study of mass killing in history, as well as in the contemporary world, his contemporary world. As a boy, his reading list familiarized him with cases from antiquity and the medieval era. So you can see he was sensitized. He also read a great deal about Carthage, as well as the fate of the Aztecs and the Incas in the New World. "I was appalled by the frequency of evil," he said, "and above all, by the impunity of the guilty." Why was the question that began to consume Lemkin. A key moment for him came in 1921. While he was studying at the University of Lvov in the Ukraine, Soghoman Telerian, an Armenian survivor, was arrested for murder after he gunned down one of the genocide's architects, Talat Pasha. And he did that in Berlin. In the same year, the leading planners and perpetrators of the Armenian genocide were freed by the British following being taken into custody after World War I. Lemkin wrote that he was shocked at the contrast. A nation, quote, "a nation was killed and the guilty persons were set free. Why is a man punished when he kills another man? But the killing of a million is a lesser crime than the killing of a single individual." Despite post-First World War prosecutions of the Turks for this term that was used, crimes against humanity, governments and public opinion leaders were still wedded to the notion that that state sovereignty, each individual nation, was more important than atrocities against the state's citizens. It was this legal impunity that annoyed and focused him more than anything else. So, we come to the term genocide. It is from the French and from the Greek. Geno, from the Greek word genus, which means birth, race of a similar kind. and cede from the Latin, which means to cut or to kill. The major text for this class includes this definition, which is, as a sociologist, I consider this to be a pretty good definition. But in your text, you will find 21 different definitions of the word genocide. And they're all attempts to try to provide a more precise description of genocide in order to clarify the ambiguities that are inherent in it and inherent in the UN definition. Also, each case represents unique features that scholars wish to highlight for our purposes today, either the UN definition, which I will give you in a bit, or the social science designation will suffice. Genocide is a form of one-sided mass killing in which a state or other authority intends to destroy a group as that group and membership in it are defined by the perpetrator. I don't remember offhand the page number with the other definitions, but I think it's close to the beginning of the book. Before the legal language was formulated and codified and the UN Genocide Convention was adopted, three additional instances of genocide scarred the mid-20th century. Joseph Stalin, leader of the Soviet Union, set in motion events designed to cause a famine to the Ukraine, to destroy the people there who were seeking independence from his rule. As a result, an estimated 7 million people perished in this farming area known as the breadbasket of Europe, with the people deprived of the food they had grown with their own hands. The Nanking Massacre, also known as the Rape of Nanking, was an episode of mass murder and mass rape committed by Japanese troops against the residents of Nanking during the Second Sino-Japanese War. The 6 weeks of carnage would become known as the Rape of Nanking and represented the single worst atrocity during the World War II era in either the European or the Pacific theaters of war. And as you can see there, if you've been to the Holocaust and Genocide Memorial Grove, there are a series of memorial bricks, and now there is a bench that is placed there in honor of the victims at Nanking, and also one for Iris Chang, a historian who wrote the first book about the rape of Nanking. So now I'm going to digress here. Sonoma State has a very interesting history and connection with not only the Armenian genocide, but the, also the Holocaust, of course, but also Nanking. As you may or may not know, we are graced with the sapling from the Anne Frank tree that is at the Grove. The Armenians of the North Bay is an organization that works with our organization, the Alliance for the Study of the Holocaust and Genocide, to bring people to the lectures and to bring information to students. And we had a professor in the sociology department who was a survivor of Auschwitz, Dr. John Steiner. We had a professor in the psychology department who was a GI who liberated the camps. Dr. Do you remember, Barbara? His name, it'll come to me. I'll tell you next week. A professor in the math department, Dr. Jean Chan, is the child of a survivor of the Nanking massacre. So we're deeply connected to all of these events that took place in the 20th century. Obviously, the Holocaust, or the Shoah, as it is known, was another scar on the 20th century. We have connections also to the Holocaust and to this picture. I believe later in the semester you may very well get to meet Lillian Judd, who is in that photograph with her family. She is the third person over from the right. And that picture was taken by the Germans on the only day they allowed cameras into Auschwitz, when a shipment or a trainload of Jews from Hungary were brought to Auschwitz. And she's a survivor. She speaks, has anybody heard her? She has spoken in some of the classrooms, schools. So, we can see that the 20th century is, up to the Holocaust, is a pretty brutal century, with giving us lots of impetus to somehow create some way of preventing and punishing the crime of genocide. Okay, for the students, this definition is in your book, but I will read it. Genocide means any of the following acts committed with the intent to destroy, in whole or in part, a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group, such as killing members of the group, causing serious bodily or mental harm to members of the group, deliberately inflicting on the group conditions of life calculated to bring about its physical destruction in whole or in part, imposing measures intended to prevent births within the group, and forcibly transferring children of the group from one group to another. Bless you. Don't write these down. Students, don't write them down. I just want you to see what the 20th century, and these are just the major genocides, what the 20th century had wrought. Okay, we have Cambodia. After Never Again, 1975-79. You will have somebody speaking later in the series who will tell you about what happened in Cambodia. East Timor, 1975-1999. Death toll, 120,000, 20% of the population. Some of you may be familiar with your own history of the Mayan genocide, which took place in Guatemala from 1981 to 1983, with an estimated tens of thousands. Anybody have a relative that fled Guatemala because of the genocide? Well, many of those people might be your neighbors. The Bosnian genocide. First time we began hearing and needing to rewrite once again the definition of genocide because of the number of Muslim women who were raped as an act of attempting to obliterate the Muslim, Bosnian Muslim community. And then Rwanda in 1994. Starting in April 1994, in over a 3-month period, 800,000 Tutsis were murdered by Hutu extremists. Actually, they weren't all extremists. They were their friends and neighbors as well. And this, the international community, which of course was pledged to stop this kind of thing, stood by. 3 months, 800,000 people. If we compare that to about 5 years, 4 or 5 years, the Germans with their death factories killing approximately 3 million, 2 to 3 million in the camps, you can see that the pace of that is just horrific. And it was done mainly without modern weapons. Another 20th century tragedy. This one is still happening. This is happening in Africa, in the Sudan. The Janjaweed militias rode into the villages, burned them, and set people fleeing. At the beginning, most of them went to Chad. It's gotten much worse. So what factors lead to genocide? We've seen all of this. Is there any way we can make any sense out of what happens in genocide? Well, one thing that's very important and an important factor that contributes to genocide is the notion, not the notion, is ideology. Ideology. Ideology is a belief, a set of beliefs, ideas, or myths that guide a political system. Adolf Hitler had a very concrete and destructive ideology. In the case of genocide, ideology is used to justify and legitimize discriminatory acts against victims. Examples of negative ideology are antisemitism or racism, but not all ideology is bad. I mean, we live in the land of the free and the home of the brave, where all men are created equal. That's an ideology. It's a set of beliefs. Okay, so how is this ideology used? Well, perpetrators use ideology to render their victims isolated, powerless, vulnerable, and outside the customary universe of moral obligation. And I'll talk more about that later. You have to separate people out. The president of a very important organization called Genocide Watch, Dr. Gregory Stanton, has put forth a typology of genocide. What are the steps? What are the stages of genocide? And I'm going to go through these kind of quickly with you. It is in your textbook. The first stage. And these stages don't always go in a linear fashion. Sometimes they go and they come back and they jump over each other. But these are sure to be ones that are a part of genocide. So by classification, we mean to distinguish by race or blood. It could be religious group, it could be any other, but he specifically was looking at genocides that had their origins in naming the other. This was what the Belgians did when they set up the rigid divisions between Hutu and Tutsi. People were identified by the shape of their nose, the shape of their ears. And these were the Belgians early in the 20th century. The Germans had a much more systematic way of doing it. As you can see, these are the Nuremberg laws that defined who was a Jew. And essentially it says what happens if you have two grandparents or three grandparents or four grandparents. All the way at the end there, you're a Jew if you have all those grandparents that are Jewish. So people are classified as to one way or another. The next step is symbolization. And that is to distinguish by physical or cultural symbols. You may have encountered this in your reading, or if you had someone come and talk to your class at school, very often they want to let you know what it's like to wear a symbol that separates you out from the rest of the people. In Cambodia, the Khmer Rouge identified potential victims by people who didn't wear a red scarf, but who wore a blue scarf. Then we come to a more formal classification in the use of law, custom, and political power to deny group rights. Dehumanization. This is an important part of moving people towards the genocidal impulse. We saw a short bit of a film in my section, and the genocidaires, the people who committed the genocide in Rwanda, talked about how they spoke of the Tutsis as cockroaches. The Germans were masters at this. They took every chance they could. Okay? Jews are made to look like vipers or snakes or leeches. As well as worms infecting the German apple. Now this may seem crude right now, but, and I don't have any examples on the tip of my tongue, but there are ways that people talk about other people that take away their humanity. They are dehumanized. It's an important step in justifying the murder of a group of people. Organization. Although some, it seems as though there are just roving bands, there has to be some organization to carry out genocide. So genocide is always collective because it derives its impetus from group identifications. It is always organized, often by states, but also by militias and hate groups. Planning does not need to be elaborate. Hindu mobs may hunt down Sikhs or Muslims led by local leaders. Methods of killing need not be complex. The Tutsis in Rwanda died from machetes. Muslims in Cambodia from hoe blades to the back of the neck. Seems as though people use whatever they have on hand. Hard to believe that 800,000 people were killed in 3 months, mainly through the use of machetes. And then we see the Janjaweed militia, who have gone into Darfur region of Sudan. Polarization happens when extremists drive groups apart. Hate groups broadcast and print polarizing propaganda. Laws are passed that forbid intermarriage or social interaction. That was in a lot of German children's picture books. Anybody speak German? You are German. Well, this is named it. Can you tell us what that says?
Yeah, it says,
Jewish people are not welcome here. Now, that's a picture book for children. The Nazis were very prolific at polarizing the population. That is a table, and not all of it is in there, of all of the anti-Jewish laws. Jews can't do this, Jews can't do that, Germans can't do this with Jews, Jews can't do this with Germans. So it is a table of anti-Jewish laws, which also serve to polarize populations. If you're going to commit genocide, you need to prepare. So national or perpetrator groups plan the final solutions to the Jewish, Armenian, Tutsi, or other targeted groups' question. They often use euphemism to cloak their intentions, such as referring to their goals as ethnic cleansing, purification, or counter-terrorism. They build armies, buy weapons, and train their troops and militias. They indoctrinate the populace with fear of the victim group. Leaders often claim that if we don't kill them, they will kill us. Prevention of preparation may include steps that can be taken by the world governments, arms embargoes, and enforceable actions. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen because people can't agree. But preparation also includes lists, ID cards, putting people in ghettos. Oops. Then we have persecution, and victims are identified and separated out because of their ethnic or religious identity. Our examples come largely from the Holocaust, which serves as somewhat of a prototypical genocide, because while in some cases not all the 10 stages are carried out in the Holocaust, they all were. identification, separation, deathlets, property exploitations, starvation, genocidal massacres are all part of persecution. People's identity cards had to have a, you know, the Jews had to have a J stamped in their identity cards. And here Jews are being led to be in certain areas. You notice the man in the forefront? You see that on his back? That's a Jewish yellow star on his back. The final stage is extermination. It's considered extermination rather than murder because the victims are not considered human. So you murder people, but you exterminate vermin. People are likened to vermin, rats, cockroaches. Killing is described by euphemisms of purification. Once again, ethnic cleansing. Targeted members of the group are killed, often including children. And because they are considered persons, their bodies are mutilated, buried in mass graves, or burnt like garbage. So there's one last step that occurs in every single genocide. Well, and it's denial. And it is the most insidious stage in some ways. Because every genocide is followed by denial. Every genocide. Mass graves are dug up and hidden. Historical records are burned or closed to historians in the case of Armenia. Even during the genocide, those committing the crimes dismiss reports as propaganda. Others deny through more subtle means by characterizing the reports as unconfirmed or alleged because they do not come from officially approved sources. By minimizing the number killed, by quarreling about whether the killing fits the legal definition of genocide, by claiming that the deaths of the perpetrating group exceeded that of the victim group, or that the deaths were the result of a civil war, not genocide. In fact, civil war and genocide are not mutually exclusive. Most genocides occur during wars. It's especially egregious. How many of you have heard someone say that Holocaust didn't happen? How could that happen? It's propaganda. It's Jewish propaganda. Well, I'm sure you have. It's especially egregious in the case of the Armenian genocide. Because the Turkish government, which was responsible perhaps in perpetuity for doing it, refuses to admit that anybody had anything to do with. It was just resettling people. Germany, to its everlasting credit, has accepted its actions during the Second World War and has worked tirelessly to accept the blame for what happened. And they are even considered at this point something called a philo-Semitic country, which means instead of anti-Semitic, they're philo-Semitic. The Turks are not, however. 1915, never again. The Holocaust is a great lie. The late 20th and early 21st century events have proven that treaties are not effective in deterring mass murder. Because the 20th century is over, right? We're in the 21st century. And it persists. The slogan, never again, persists, and yet, Darfur. So I say, never again or ever again. Because right now, there are genocidal actions taking place in Sudan, Iraq, Somalia, the Central African Republic, Myanmar, which used to be known as Burma, Nigeria, Burundi. In the Sudan, two regions, still Darfur in the pink and South Sudan right in the center. South Kordofan, the Blue Nile and districts and Darfur have suffered from long-term political and economic marginalization. The conflict in the south has left 1.2 million people internally displaced since June of 2011, and another 246,000 have taken refuge in South Sudan and Ethiopia. The most recent genocide in Darfur began in 2003 when the Sudanese government and Arab militias, the Janjaweed, fellows on the camels, destroyed over 400 villages, allegedly in response to two opposition groups. There's always an excuse. Sudan is a region on the edge of genocide. Iraq. You see that says 1988? That's when the Kurds in Iraq were, many of whom were sent to their deaths by the use of mustard gas. ISIS fighters who have already driven out Christians from their ancestral homes in northern Iraq have been especially targeting the Yazis, or Kurdish people. How many of you have heard that word? Raise your hand. Okay, that's good. That's good. Not perfect, but it's good. There they are. Make no, you know, their actions are aimed at genocide. Somalia. The organization Genocide Watch has issued a genocide emergency for Somalia. Complex civil conflicts, along with devastating periods of drought over the past two decades, have left the Republic of Somalia a failed state. There are people who call the condition in Somalia the world's worst humanitarian disaster. I'll bet you none of you hear about that, but what did Kim Kardashian name her last child? What?
Saint.
How many of you knew that? My colleagues are laughing. Genocide Watch has also issued a genocide emergency in the Central African Republic. Continuing violence between the Christian majority and Muslim minorities have been genocidal because the victims are targeted for their religious identity. right today that's happening. Myanmar. How many people have heard of the Rohingya? Rohingya. They're a Muslim ethnic minority in Burma. There are a million of them, and they have lived in a state in Burma for centuries, but they're facing systematic religious and ethnic discrimination there. They are not a recognized ethnic minority and are therefore robbed of the rights inherent in citizenship in Burma. And they have become one of the most oppressed ethnic groups in the world. Rohingya. Who knows who that is? Yeah. Yes. Thank you for, Buddhists. Peace and love. Who is that? There is not a Kardashian in the moon. How many of you have heard of, I'm making light of all of this, because to be frank with you, it's hard to be knee-deep in all of this without needing some kind of relief. But how many of you have heard of Boko Haram? Come on, raise your hand so I can see. Okay, not enough of you. Those are the 200 girls that they took hostage from a Christian school. Boko Haram, literally translated, is Western education is a sin. It is a genocidal criminal movement led by an Islamicist extremist. They have vowed to destroy every Christian school in Nigeria and to carry out terrorist acts on Nigerian government police and government officials. They kidnapped over 200 girls from a Christian school in April of 2014. And despite the Nigerian government's efforts, none have been found. I think some have since I wrote that. Some of them escaped. Was it all of them? No. All right. They have killed an estimated 2,000 people in their jihad, and they're also active in northern Nigeria. Burundi, it's the next door neighbor to Rwanda. Over a period of time, many Tutsis fled to Burundi to escape what was going on in Rwanda. But since their independence from Belgium in 1962, there have been sporadic bursts of ethnic violence between the Hutu majority and the Tutsi minority in Burundi. Civil unrest erupted in Burundi this year following the 26th of April announcement by the ruling party council, Council National for the Defense of the Democracy, and their forces for the defense of the democratic democracy. And they announced that their president would run for a third term in 2015. This is very active right now. This is almost on page 18 of your newspaper, but it is very, very active. The current conflict is political in nature, not necessarily ethnic, but there is a risk of it reigniting the old divisions between Hutu and Tutsi. In present-day Rwanda, they no longer talk about Hutu and Tutsi. They say we are all Rwandans. And it has been very successful in preventing additional ethnic violence. Now, Helen Fine wrote a book called Accounting for Genocide, and she did all of these statistical manipulations to try and show what were the reasons that some countries were that were occupied by the Germans were their allies and helped them kill Jews, and some didn't, which I thought was a kind of statistics has its place, but I think it doesn't really explain much. But she coined this term, which she took from a very famous French sociologist. And she talks about the universe of moral obligation and defines it as that circle of persons to whom obligations are owed, to whom the rules apply, and whose injuries call for attention and healing. And it would seem to me that if someone is in your universe of moral obligation, you are prepared to stand up and do something. The fewer shared values in a society, the more likely members of the outgroup are to find themselves beyond this universe of obligation. What can I do? What can we do? All this bad news. It's all the way on the other side of the world. I have to make my car payment. My roommate is leaving dishes in the sink every single day. And I'm not belittling that. It's a, you know, that's how our lives are occupied. And it's hard for us to think about some poor child in Burma or someplace or Syria and feel as though we're helpless. What can I do? Well, I believe that even the slightest action of some kind, when done by lots of people, it's the same thing with voting. One vote doesn't count, but when everybody votes, it does count. There are some organizations that are doing things all over the world to try and help the people who are suffering. So one of them is Mercy Corps. They're in, and I've just given you a few. You know, you may have your own. There are ones that I believe are doing, you know, I've investigated them and I believe that they're doing good work. Portland, Oregon, in something like 42 countries, addressing the needs of people so that situations do not become genocidal, but also addressing the injuries that people are suffering. Previously mentioned Genocide Watch. You can keep yourself informed by going to their website. They have up-to-the-minute information about all of the situations that are going on. The International Rescue Committee. It's a global humanitarian fund and an NGO, another NGO, and was founded at the request of Albert Einstein in 1933, when there were a lot of refugees who needed help because they were fleeing the Nazi sphere of influence. They work in over 40 countries. It's one of my designated places that I take that extra money that I'm going to use to try and do some good. There are lots of others, and I'm sure some of you know some of those. Some of you may even be interested someday in working for these organizations. So, usually like to end with this. I can't believe the world stood by and did nothing in Rwanda. And they're wondering when Hotel Sudan will be released. It's kind of the way we get our information these days, is through movies. So maybe you could look at the front page. I know Google News does a pretty good job, but I hope I've... I hope I left you with a lot of information, but also at the end with some sense of not feeling desperate, because the world is such a bad place for a lot of people. Any questions? Yes.
I have
two questions. At the question is, has there been anything that's helped in the past that we can lean on now to give us some guidance? And I wish I could say yes, because ultimately what's happening in the Sudan is an issue around the very, 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 very rich oil fields in South Sudan that gives the government there the permission to do what they want, because we all need to run our cars and turn on our lights, etc. So, you know, I think probably writing to your, well, Congress, President. I didn't mean for this to be an absolute downer. I don't see what the global solution is, but I do see that if people of goodwill were to find organizations that are at least working to alleviate the suffering, that that might help, especially ones that are going in before the genocide happens, before one group of people has more than the other group of people. The ones that go in and teach girls, put them in school, the ones that take care of their basic health needs. And so, unfortunately, in this big world, it may be something that has to be done one person at a time. Okay, question number two.
Yeah.
Turkish. Oh, the Brits, yes, yeah, had them at Malta.
Yeah, it's like they were released and some of that. Like, why is it like they, like, there was a statement released, saying, like, why that they were released at all? Like,
they were released because the new Turkish government was a potential power in the Middle East. And they wanted their criminals back. That was essentially it. The people who were the perpetrators were part of the Turkish government during the before and during the First World War. Okay? Right. Well, because the world has not learned anything, it's kind of a simplistic way of putting it, but the Holocaust is the prototypical genocide. Whenever we look at any genocide, no matter what went on, it happened during the Holocaust as well. I don't think I was particularly interested in comparing it, because I don't compare it. What I think is being compared are the processes and not the instances. So we can see that people were separated into groups, but we can see where it happened in the Holocaust and it happened in other places as well. That isn't necessarily comparing the whole process as one, but I agree with you. Right. Well, this is to show you how fragmented this whole thing is. People who say that situations that happen because of regime change or other things, they're calling them politicized sides. And there's democides. And then there are other sides. And the 21 definition of genocides that is in the textbook also contains a whole litany of different sides, C-I-D-E, sides. Yes? And it's used very loosely.
Or very reluctantly.
Yeah.
Very hard to say this is a genocide.
The simple fact of the matter is that when you understand it the way Lemkin described it, it's all over. It's going to be with us. The targeting of a group and the attempt to destroy the group entire. Barbara?
I'm thinking of some of the things that have been done by students in this class in the past to try to respond to what's going on in the world, whether it was participating in fundraising for the walk against genocide or the annual support that this group has given to an orphanage for those in Rwanda. That a former speaker in this series, who's now the ambassador from Rwanda to the United States, has been involved with, that there are things that one could do, even if one's time or resources are limited. And I think, you know, I've been thinking very deeply about all the political talk that's going on, whether it's anti-immigrant or anti-Muslim, and it reminds me that we are in early stages. We could easily be in the early stages of targeting another group of people. And I think one of the things that I'm realizing is the need to become politically active, or at least keep myself informed. And I'm thinking those are all small positive steps that one could do in the face of genocide, rather than be overwhelmed by the information, of course, at, if you will, people's inhumanity toward one another.
Sure. I'm going to have to convince Diane that I need a second lecture every year on next week. Well, the subject next week. The point was taken that I have studied the Danish exception, as it were. The governments in Europe at the time of the Holocaust, and you will read in your readings about pressures on various governments, were pressured to give up the Jews in their country to the Germans, who shipped them to the death camps in Poland. In Western Europe, or in, and I'll include Denmark in Western Europe, there were some countries that had some control over their lives. In Poland, the Germans were there, and if you were hiding a Jew and you got caught, the Jew was killed, you were killed, your wife was killed, your children were killed, your mother was killed, your father was killed. Was a very, very dangerous adventure to try and help a Jew. And it's no, you know, we need to ponder the fact that in Poland there are more Polish people who have been recognized as righteous persons, people who stood up. You're going to hear about one of them next week, who is probably the most famous. In Denmark, they were occupied by the Germans, but has anybody been to Denmark? Have any of you been to Denmark? Yeah. How many of you have read Hans Christian Andersen? Okay. The country's really like that. I mean, they have a kind of different way of looking at life. And from the very beginning, they refused to separate out the Jews. You know, when approached about the possibility of gathering his Jews together to be shipped to the camps, the king said, you know, there are no Jews in Denmark, they're only my people. I mean, the Danish church refused to separate them out. There are all of these ways in which they didn't categorize people in a negative way. It is a wonderful story that Hans Christian Andersen could have written, because not only were the Danes able to maneuver themselves with the Germans so that the Germans were kind of a bit more interested in shipping Danish butter and cheese and pork and other things to Germany than they were taking the small number of Jews that lived there. But it is quite an antidote to all of this. And I would say that next week we're going to hear about someone who took much, much more dangerous steps to try and save, or at least let people know what the Germans were doing to the Jews. Yes? Yes. Right, and there was a feeling in Denmark that what was German was definitely not Danish. So every chance they took, or in every way they thought about Germany, and that is due to a lot of historical things that happened. Yes. Yes. The Danish Parliament passed a law that said that anybody who wants to come to Denmark as an immigrant or a refugee can only keep $1,400 in possessions. Everything else they have to give up to the government. And everybody I know goes, oh, they're terrible just like everybody else. But the Danish government's explanation is, when you come to Denmark and we take you in, you automatically qualify for all of the services and benefits of living in Denmark. You will get assistance learning how to read, you'll get, or you know, learn the language, you'll get housing support, you'll get food if you need it, and they are not taking anything that has any sentimental value. So on the one hand, you know, boy, that's pretty crummy. They're, these poor people, they're taking everything they have. They're not taking everything, and they are embracing them into their welfare system, which is the envy of the world. I would love to live in a country where I had 8 weeks vacation. Right? Yes? That's not genocide. It doesn't follow the definition of genocide. Yes, but there are also people who stayed who are now citizens. You know, I've thought a lot about it. And one of the things that I think the people that should be accused of genocide are the Jordanians and the Syrians and some of the other Arab countries who refused to give the Palestinians any aid whatsoever. It was to their best interests in many cases to let them suffer. So you can't be, if you're a Palestinian, you cannot be a citizen of Jordan, can't be a citizen of Syria, have trouble in Egypt. The Palestinian people have just, it's horrible what they've experienced, but what their dealings with Israel is not genocide. If you look in Jones, the big thick book, you might find a side that'll describe what's happening to the Palestinians. But there's no attempt to destroy them in whole or in part. Any others? Yes. Which war? The Vietnam War? Yeah.
But dehumanization really sort of seems like a turning point in a lot of these genocides, because once you don't see some of these human beings, it's really easy just to say, yeah, who cares? You know, it doesn't matter. They're not really suffering or anything.
Right.
They don't deserve to live anyway. They're beautiful or whatever. And so there's like so many overwhelming things in what you've said about the genocides. Yeah.
they go out.
That's
so President Ahmadinejad is on record saying that the U.S. committed genocide in the years after 9/11 in the U.S.'s campaign in the Middle East.
U.S. committed genocide.
Yeah. According to President Ahmadinejad of Iran, what is your opinion on the matter, and does it qualify as genocide in your opinion?
It's not something I would like to face up to, but I did do that little piece on what happened to
I'm talking about the Middle East.
In the Middle East?
Yeah. Right after 9/11.
He also said the Holocaust didn't happen.
What is it?
The Holocaust never happened.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. So,
it's kind of off topic.
I mean, you talk about trying to stir someone. Say to the Israelis, Holocaust. Okay. Someone else? Hiding?
I will raise my hand at one point because my dad grew up in Gaza and, and as a missionary player, right? And he went back about 8 years ago. And, you know, he described the horrific conditions.